Hello, Malty. Mind-bending malt moments. And thank you to Rosemary in Ontario for that malt mention introducing Whisky Review 490. And it's a blended Scotch, 12-year-old Hankey Bannister Regency, bottled at 40%. It's chill-filtered. It's probably got a bit of caramel in it. So what? It's blended Scotch. And I'm going to pour a glass and tell you all about it. It's good for single malt drinkers to go out and buy a blend every now and again. I recommend for single malt drinkers in particular that your every sixth bottle that you buy is in fact a blend, because when they have an age statement on them above 10 years, 12 years, 14 years, 16, maybe even 18 years, you can find some really good whiskies. The majority of whisky sales around the world are still Scotch blend, a mixture of malts and grains. Single malts are still a minority, although they are an increasingly profitable minority of Scotch whisky sales. The bread and butter remains the bottles of blend. And I shall nose, I shall taste, I shall share. Simple as that. One of the risks with a blend is that you can smell the corn whiskey, the grain whiskey as they call it, from column stills, predominantly corn, imported corn spirit, which makes up the bulk of these blends. But with experience, you get to become aware of a successfully produced blend is the skillful combination of properly matured grain and malt whiskies in balance, producing a complex result which is more than the sum of its parts. That's the theory. Let's try the nose. Yep, mission accomplished. As soon as I had first taste of this blend, I was starting to get impressed. And you know, the enjoyment it's not even starting to wane yet. And the great thing is, having tasted a bit of blended whiskey, you go back to single malt with a slightly different perspective. It's true, you know, if you spend too much time with one style of spirit, you become institutionalised. And that's an opinion. There's a soft, toffee, gentle, clean, fresh fruit, green banana, mild, complex, soft spice, hint of cinnamon, touch of ginger, sweet ginger. Wonderful floral note. I would say a kind of Bal Blair floral note, because it's the same company as produce this blend and who own Bal Blair. And there's this quite complex blended tea note that you're getting behind the fresh fruit and the spices. It's without doubt, you know, a lot of folk have Johnny Walker Black Label as their favourite go-to blend. And my advice is, if you can't find that, buy this. This is one of these wonderful, overlooked, off-the-radar blended scotches that tends not to get much of a mention. But it's Ralphie.com, isn't it? And I'm on the lookout for these things, and that's why it's going to get a great big fat mention here. Taste. Oh, yeah. Youthful, but mature. Starts sweet and light, becomes more fresh fruit, dried fruit. Spiciness creeps in along with some pickled ginger. And I'm not talking hot, by the way. This is not a hot whiskey by any means. The components of this blend are good stuff. It has a lovely, soft, smooth complexity from beginning right through development, right into the finish, where it remains. There is a hint of peat about it, but it really is a hint. This is very much the soft, Speyside Highland character blend. And, excuse me, I've got to have another taste. I won't be a minute. Carry on without me. Dry, creamy, vanilla, complex, floral, grain, rich graininess. And, you know, it's the grain whisky that's doing it. The combination, the gelling and bringing together, the marriage of the grain whisky and the single malts is really well done. And in my opinion, there's not that many single malts making up this blend, because there's such a character going through the development into the finish. With a drop of water, and bear in mind you saw me put it in, it's only a few seconds ago. Immediately impacts on the flavour. Prolongs the arrival, softer development, more subtle, more syrupy, golden syrup, icing sugar. And yet, at the back you've still got those slight eau de cologne complex, slight mint, that's what it is. I'm going to say wintergreen, but it's actually slight spearmint, refreshing mint. Mint as you get in toothpaste, that sort of mintiness, that's there. But in the most pleasant, complex way. Vanilla in the finish, you've got a lovely soft, soft tannins, a little bit of pickled ginger, and altogether, just a delightful experience. Highly Ralphie recommended for a blend. $89 out of $100. That's a blend mark. Now, moving on to part two, second half of this review. As you know, I tend to chunter on like an old school malt snob about caramel in whiskey, in single malts primarily, about this colourant that's put in for cosmetic purposes, about the chill filtration, which strips away mouthfeel and compromises the delivery of the experience. And I tend to complain about whiskies, single malts primarily, being bottled at 40%, because even 43% can make quite a difference in the delivery of the experience, as you American malt mates well know, because a lot of the single malts that are available at 40% volume in Australia and New Zealand and Canada and Europe are actually at 43% in the United States, because it's just a more demanding market. Simple as that. But I have to say, in the case of blends, people are not single malt anoraks when it comes to blends. It's a different drinking environment, a different drinking experience. It tends to be something that's more casual, more social. And a result of which, bottling at 40% chill filtered with the addition of colour actually helps the blend drinker experience a comfortable, unchallenging version of that whiskey. If they were to get Castreth single malt, which we know we have to give it time to open up, we have to add a certain amount of water, we have to make sure we're in the mood for it. You know, there's actually quite a bit of work involved and experience involved in being a single malt drinker, particularly of small batch and cask strength malts. But for the blend drinker, different environment, different circumstances, and it really would be snobbery and intolerant and unreasonable to be too judgmental about the fact that many blends are bottled at 40% chill filtered and coloured up, because they can still be very good whiskies. And there is evidence to show that when it comes to blends of whiskies, grain and malt, a little drop of caramel and the effect of some chill filtration actually assists in holding the continuity of the blend. There we go. It's debatable, but there is evidence there. Certainly anecdotal evidence. But it's worth keeping an eye out for the simple reason that which would you rather buy these days? A disappointing, immature, non-age statement single malt, or a rounded, well-blended, age statement blended scotch? I would choose this over quite a number of non-age statement single malts that I've tasted recently. I really, really would. There has been a few. Mercifully, I didn't buy them. It was from friends. Try this, what do you think? And I'll always respect people with an honest opinion because I've got no reason not to. Know the difference between spirit-driven and immature. A spirit-driven whiskey can be young and good, but immature whiskey is immature whiskey, and you will always know maturity, whether it be blend or whether it be single malts. Quality will always expose itself, and it's up to us to get to know the difference. It makes for a longer journey in fairer weather, that's for sure. I'm Ralphie, end of this little vlog journey for the moment. Join me again shortly, probably be on location. Whiskey Review 491, it's on its way. Haste you back. Slange.